a very special roundtable. As we celebrate our 70th Independence Day, today we are here to debate what exactly do we mean by the idea of India. We need to go beyond labels. We've heard talks about this is Modi's India, that was Vajpayee's India, there was a Nehruvian India. But let's cut across these labels and get to the heart of the matter. Joining me for this on the roundtable is Manish Tiwari from the Congress. We have Jay Panda from the BJD and Dr. Subramanian Swamy from the BJP. Dr. Swamy, I know I said let's go beyond labels, but I want to also, you know, just touch upon one little thing before we go beyond political talk. Is the Vice President, before he retired in his farewell speech, he talked about saying that Muslims are feeling insecure, and he also said this atmosphere of hyper-nationalism is actually dwells on the insecurity that a person is facing.
Well, I mean, it's possible that Muslims are feeling insecure because what they see in the media and so on, whether it's rational or irrational, that feeling of insecurity can take place. But what I'm finding more disturbing is that there is insecurity in the Hindu community. They feel that this terrorism and the people going caught every day is spreading to South India, etc., and all in the name of Islam. And they are getting recruited. People are getting recruited from here. They are educated people, doctors, lawyers, etc. So there is a feeling now, who do we trust? Now that's a very dangerous development. In my opinion, I think the Hindu and Muslim leaders should sit down and find out how to develop confidence. One definite thing that is being said every time is that the Muslim intellectuals don't denounce the terrorists. They don't call them kafirs. They say, no, this is not real Islam. Then they are all using Islamic language, quoting chapter and verse of Quran. So there should be some denunciation where you disown these people. And somehow the bonding with each other must take place by finding common grounds. I have said one of the ways to find bonding is if the Muslims openly acknowledge that their ancestors are Hindus, which is what the genetic theory says.
We've had this debate before, Manish, so I want a quick rebuttal from you and then we'll move on.
How far back in history do you really want to go? So, in fact, Dr. Swamy is taught at Harvard. There is a colleague of his called Nayan Chanda, who's teaching at Yale. He's written a book on globalization. And if you read Nayan Chanda's book on globalization, it says that all Indians can actually trace their ancestry back to a common African mother. So, therefore, if you start taking a revisionist view of history, you can go as far back as possible. But you know what Dr. Swamy said is interesting. So therefore, the Vice President of India says that Muslims are insecure. Dr. Swamy says that the Hindus are insecure. And so therefore, we must pause and ask ourselves that in the past 3 years, why has this country become so insecure? If everybody is insecure, the Muslims say that they are insecure, Dr. Swamy says that the Hindus are insecure, then why is it that the country has become so insecure? There is a specter of, I would not use the word terror, but there is a specter of very deep insecurity which hangs over this land. And the reason for that is because in the last 3 years, systematically, social cohesion has been broken down at a deeper psychological level. The syncretic bonding between the two communities, because ultimately the great Indian experience as to how does it vary from the experience of the Middle East or even in the manner in which Europe or the United States of America has dealt with the entire problem which terrorism in the name of Islam has created is that we have surmounted it over all these years by our bonds of syncretism. And those bonds of syncretism in the last 38 months have unfortunately got strained, and we've almost come to a breaking point. And therefore, governments will come and governments will go. I mean, whether you have a 5-year cycle or a 10-year cycle. But the fact is that governments will only be there, if this country survives. And we are at really, I don't want to over-dramatize it, but at an existential point or at an inflection point in the history of this country.
Jack, this idea of insecure India, I think that's, we've begun debating with that.
Look, I think we've heard some strong but extreme positions. I think there is more nuance into this. Let me explain what I mean.
Okay.
The idea of India really should mean what the Constitution says. What India is today, the Republic of India, is defined by the Constitution. And yet that has not been the case for the past 7 decades. There has been a construct out there in civil society, in the way we do politics, which has varied from what the Constitution guarantees us. And I think that, and I think this goes back to what Manish was saying about the bonds within our communities of syncretic tradition, these are being examined. Let me give you 2 examples. If you remember, turn the clock back a few years ago, and a former prime minister had made a comment that was quite a lot in the news, that the minorities have the first right of all,
first claim
on the nation. Now, you see, that I think is under challenge, and the Constitution doesn't provide for that. Constitution doesn't provide either anybody belonging to a majority religion or a minority religion or no religion should have any special priorities. Constitution says everybody is equal. So you go back to what the outgoing vice president has said. He has said that the slogan of the current government, Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas, is actually laudable. His problem is that he thinks, or he says, that it is not probably being implemented. Maybe we should discuss about the implementation, but he has no problem with the slogan Sabka Saath, Sabka Vikas. So I would say the following. Let me give you one more example which I think will establish this. Now take the issue of a uniform civil code. In the Constitution, it says it is desirable and we must work towards it. Yet the unwritten understanding had been that we keep kicking the ball down the field without dealing with the issue. So 70 years have gone by, and the people who are holding the narrative hostage, whether from the majority side or the minority side, are not the progressive, are not political leaders, but people who hold on to issues which are not guaranteed by the Constitution. So I think if we all agree that the idea of India is and should be what the Constitution guarantees us, then clearly there is room for examination, because some of these constructs are not aligned with the Constitution, and that examination is going on, and I think it's a good thing.
Just moving away a bit, Dr. Swamy, the idea of India, what does that really mean for you? You know, we've
It's the identity of India.
Okay.
And the identity of Indians. Who are we? There have been this garbage piled on us through the British, that they were originally Dravidians, and then the Aryans came from Europe through Khyber Pass, and they are now 2 communities, Aryans and Dravidians, which is rubbish. And Nayan Chanda would lose his job if he said anything contrary to what you are quoted him as saying. But the fact is that I am willing to have a separate debate to show that all this African and all is rubbish. It has no foundation whatsoever in any scientific material. But that's a separate subject. Yeah. He has expressed his point of view. I'm expressing my point of view, that we never came from anywhere. There were trickles here and there. Yeah. The Greeks came, the Thai came, Ahom created Ahom dynasty. I'm not on that. The question is, he says that the idea of India is the Constitution.
Yeah, I think that's a
all right.
good statement to go with.
Well, I mean, it's not such a good statement,
well,
because I trapped in a debate OIC on this. He also said the same thing. I said, all right, then Article 48 of the Directive Principles says that there shall be a ban on cow slaughter. Will you support that? So he said, well, that's Directive Principles. No, Article 37 says it shall be the duty of the government, as a principle of governance, to implement these things. There is only thing I can't go and on my fundamental rights and say that no, I have not been given a uniform civil code. But it is a directive to the government to get it implemented, which we have not done.
Right.
Then Article 351 says that Hindi shall be the official language, and the words shall be preferably taken from Sanskrit, the vocabulary. Do you agree with that? And that the script should be Devanagari. So there are lots of things in the Constitution which will tell you that what I am saying is the correct thing, that the founding fathers had a concept of a cultural India, which was a continuing civilization. And if some people came here, there, some people tried to conquer this country, failed, ultimately we prevailed. And that while I don't say we are a Hindu Rashtra, I do think that we are a Hindustan. and where either you are in Hindu or your ancestors are Hindus.
So we're coming back to the Hindu identity, I think, Manish. But what about aspirational India, if we just move away a bit from the cultural question?
My personal take is that the framers of the Indian constitution actually erred by including part 4, the directive principles of state policy within the constitutional framework of India. Now coming back to this question, that what is the idea of India? I don't want to stretch into antiquity, but can it be said for the purposes of argument that at some point in time in history this country belonged to a single religion? And the answer is no, because even before, let's say, a single religion became predominant in India, you know, there is documented evidence with regard to paganism, right? That the ancestors actually, or the people who came and populated this land before organized religion came in, were pagans in that sense of the word. So therefore, you've had a syncretic ethos which has evolved over 20 millennia. And ultimately, if you were to condense it to an inflection point, which is 1947, the independence of India, you had two choices. You could be a Hindu Pakistan, because you had a division on religious lines, or you could be the liberal and the pluralistic idea of India that we are. Yes, Jay is right. That idea has been under stress. It has been under challenge. And there are certain postulates which are open for examination, as they should be in any democracy, because over the period of the last 70 years, aberrations have crept in. And I think a debate on all of that is more than welcome. But to actually deviate from that and say that, all right, we will not be a liberal pluralistic republic, then what are you going to go back to? Then you are going to go back to a denominational identity, which actually would be the mirror image of the speech which Muhammad Ali Jinnah gave in the March of 1940, when he actually expounded on the concept of what Pakistan is.
Tending to agree with Manish.
Well, that's because you haven't heard the counter to that.
Okay, yeah, we have to give the counter, yes.
The counter to that is very simple. Yes, India is an ancient civilization, and many of our core tenets which are in the constitution go far beyond the constitution. They come from our history. We have had secularism and tolerance and multiculturalism and that syncretic tradition long before the constitution was written. But the fact is, we are a republic today based on the constitution.
Right.
Okay. And I think both Dr. Swamy and Manish have pointed out that some aspects of the constitution may not suit everybody who claims to live by the constitution. But let's first agree that whatever is there in the constitution, we have to abide by unless and until we can get amendments to change that, right? That has to be the fundamental understanding. Democracies have certain features, whether they're in the constitution or not. And one of the key features of any democracy is every individual is equal. We talked earlier about people belonging to religions. That's one aspect. Another aspect is the constitution, I mean, our democracy should not recognize group rights versus individual rights. We don't give rights to khap panchayats to decide how their community will live beyond what the constitution provides them. We should not be giving such group rights, such communal community rights. It has to be every individual has to have same rights. So some of these ideas which are getting challenged is because of this dichotomy. The dichotomy of what democracies are about and what our constitution guarantees and what has been an unsaid understanding about many things. One final thing I'd like to say is, there are fringe elements on both sides. If you look at the extreme right, there are fringe elements which certain governments are accused of tolerating, and they disavow them. But don't forget that there are fringe elements on the left, and earlier governments have been accused of tolerating those left fringe elements. Also. So neither of the fringe ought to be what sets the narrative. It has to be the common understanding as per the elections of the country.
Okay, I'm going to go in for a break, but before the break, Jay, you're one person who's known for shaking systems. So is it time to have another look at the constitution?
I think a simple answer I would say is that it's going to be very difficult. Best democracies don't get rid of their constitution. They stay in the same republic and make amendments. I have a simple question. Our founding fathers and mothers were all very, very tall statesmen, statespeople, and who had great acceptance by the people of this country. Can we put together 50 such people today
whose
combined wisdom will be accepted by all without being attacked by others?
Okay. And we'll come back to both Manish and Dr. Swamy, but a quick break. Stay with us. Welcome back to a very special roundtable as we celebrate 70 years of Indian independence. We are asking the question that is it now the time to take another look at our constitution? And both Manish and Dr. Swamy had something to say.
No. Dr. Swamy.
Jay Panda, of course, before the break said no.
Yeah. But there's no question of another constitution because of the basic structure decision.
But re-looking and
reworking. Which are you going to amend? The basic structure is the one that remains the philosophy of the constitution. And that you can't amend. So the question of whether I should have, instead of Hindi, I should have Sanskrit, that's not the, that's not a very big change.
Mm.
So the one, number one. Number two, this pluralism that he keeps talking about, Manish, if you look at the fact that the Parsis, the Jews, the Syrian Christians, they came here, they were absolutely unpersecuted. In fact, the Jews went back to Israel and passed a resolution that they are the only nation, India is the only nation which did not persecute Jews.
Hmm.
Parsis are totally integrated. It is only Islam and Christianity which says there's only one path, and that is our path. Either you are a kafir if, in case you don't follow this path, or you are seized by the devil, you are a pagan. That's what the Christians say.
Right.
The only religion which says that all religions lead to God is Hinduism. And how can you say that they intrinsically all these Hindu right, etc. If you are a good Hindu, you can never, never be a bigot.
No, Priya, see, an attempt was made to review the constitution. When Mr. Vajpayee was Prime Minister, a committee to review the constitution was set up, and therefore they went into various aspects of the constitution and ultimately hit the basic structure. Now, within that, is there scope to amend, to delete, to add? Well, we've been doing that since 1950. You know, we've done 121 odd constitutional amendments, and I think that's a natural process of evolution. Now, with regard to as to whether a particular religion is plural or another religion is not plural, well, that can be an individual point of view. For example, if you look at Hinduism, you know, Hinduism has 32 million gods. And as Dr. Swamy was pointing out, both he and I are married to Parsis. You know, the Parsi faith is also monolithic in a certain sense of the word. Mm. But yes, the Parsis have got fully integrated. So therefore, if we've not been able to integrate certain minorities, I think rather than demonizing those minorities, there is a need to reflect and introspect as to how we can involve everybody into the mainstream.
Every time I nod my head, Dr. Swamy smiles. So Manish, you got two diverse reactions. But Jay, we would comment on this.
Well, look, I think there is a common core where, despite our differences in where we stand politically, there is a common core that is representative of India as a whole. Dr. Swamy has clarified that a true Hindu can't be a bigot. Manish was pointing out about the acceptance of the different religions in India, but it's not all about religion.
Hmm.
Again, let me keep coming back to the issue that we are not a theistic country, unlike Pakistan. So we can't be a Hindu Pakistan because Pakistan is a theistic country. It's an Islamic republic. We are not a Hindu republic.
So we have that option. We had that option.
But we are today not it.
Yeah.
So that's why I keep repeating that what we are today, and we both agree on this, is bound together by the constitution. And what the constitution guarantees, and which is not exactly the case always in all our laws and all our public understanding, is that every citizen is equal.
Hmm.
We do have special rights, we do have special laws. That is under examination. That is why the idea of India that is under examination is this wink, wink, nudge, nudge understanding of India, not the constitutional guarantees of India.
That's very well put, I must say.
I'll come in after Dr. Swamy.
Let me just briefly say, the issue of minorities cannot be used in a generic sense, in the sense that Parsis are minorities, we have no problem with them. Jews are minorities, no problem with them. Syrian Christians are minorities, we have no problem. The problem is with those minorities who ruled India and brutalized India. today they want special protection. The vast majority of Hindus who have suffered under 800 plus 200 years of these people's rule, they resent it. So it's a question of making out a case. And if on top of that you have Christians doing conversions here, Muslims coming here as a terrorist, it creates a problem. And therefore, we have to grapple with that. And one way of grappling with that is to say, first, the Hindus get united. And once Hindus get united, then I'm afraid it will be very difficult for any other party to win except BJP.
The debate comes up to here, which is not only about religion, but when it comes back here, we again go back.
No, but Priya, coming to Jay's point with regard to special rights, you know, he says that what is under examination is the special rights which have been constitutionally granted, you know, to certain citizens or to certain sections. The fact is that we don't live in an ideal world. The fact is that we don't live in a utopian world. You know, when we negotiated the entire nationhood of India and brought certain diverse elements within our field, so therefore, you know, we can very well take this position that in theory everybody should be equal, but the manner in which the Indian experiment has evolved over a period of time has necessitated that certain compromises have been made along the way in order to keep hold the idea together. For example, the special rights which have been given to the Bodo people, or for that matter what has been done in Kachar Hills, and which happened at the time of independence and the framing of the constitution.
Dr. Swamy doesn't have a problem in giving the rights, but he's saying the person
So therefore, when he says that, you know, Muslims and Christians have ruled over India, he's absolutely correct. From 1000 AD to 1707, or even beyond that, almost till 1857, you had the Muslims who ruled India, and after that the British who ruled India. But if you really look at the proselytization question, if the British were really here to convert, and I don't hold a brief for the British, how come in 100 years of British rule we have only 2% Christians?
That's a tribute to the Hindus.
No, I mean, so therefore, while, you know, a lot of other things fell to their sword, you know, why is it that conversion did not take place? And the answer is very clear. The British were here to actually commercially exploit. They were rapacious about India. They were not interested in the Christian faith.
No, I don't agree with that. First of all, every country which, for instance, whole of Europe was converted after the Christians took over in 50 years to 100% Christian. Every country conquered by Islam, like Iran, Mesopotamia, Babylon, Egypt, all converted 100% to Islam. In India, they didn't. Neither the Christians could do it, nor the, because there was consistent fighting against it. Whether it was Shivaji here, or losers like Rana Pratap, or Vijayanagaram, or the Ahom dynasty, or Guru Gobind Singh, there was continuous rebellion in India, which is not reflected in the history books, which the Congress government also continued, which is written mostly by Britishers or their stooges.
Okay, last word, can I
get
the last word?
Let me just address this. We are a republic, we are the world's largest democracy, the world celebrates this about us. We need to celebrate a bit more about this. But what that means is we cannot continue to live on the illusion that the world is not perfect, so even if we are not really fully implementing our constitutional guarantees, it's okay, we can continue to bumble along like this. It was maybe necessary because of the traumatic circumstances of partition, of the birth of our nation, that many special arrangements had to be made. But after 70 years, I think it is legitimate that the people are asking that will these special arrangements continue in perpetuity, or what is guaranteed in the constitution, what is understood as, commonly understood as democratic rights for every individual, when will it happen? If not in 70 years, will it be another 70 years, another 700 years? So it is a legitimate debate that is taking place. One final word. If you look at other major democracies, look at the US for instance, they have had special arrangements when they took over the native Indian areas, or when they acquired territories from the French or the British. But over a period of several decades, they got normalized. you know, in technicality, Texas might have some footnote somewhere in its state charter that it can secede from the U.S. if it wants to. Can they? They can't. The U.S. Constitution will not permit it. So my point is, 70 years is long enough for us to say that perhaps it is time to accept that we are bound together as a nation, our existence is not in threat, and we have to start providing the equal rights to everybody that our constitution guarantees.
May I have one quick line? You know, was the evolution of India really a straight fight between the Hindus and Muslims, as Dr. Swamy makes it out to be? I do not think so. Because if you look at it, who was the head of Maharana Pratap's artillery? It was a Pathan general called Ghaus Khan. Who invited the Muslim invaders to come to India at different points in time? It was their Hindu rivals. So therefore, you know, it was more of a construct whereby states, feudal territories were at war with each other. It was not really a straight black and white Hindu-Muslim fight.
Well, okay, on this note, I will say that he's actually proved my point, but that is for another occasion.
Well, he's proved your point. Okay, since everybody agrees, I will not go any further, but that's it for now. Thank you for watching this show. We'll see you again same time next week.